Good morning, Harvest. Man, what a fun way to start a Sunday morning together. I don't know how many of you guys were doing the exercises and saw all the fun references to the Word of God in that. So hopefully you guys enjoyed that. We want to start with laughter and really build that excitement. And so one thing I'm looking forward to is today is the day of the week where we get to connect as Harvest, as a body. And so one way to do that is as you see people logging in, if you're on your phone or you've casted it to your TV or something like that, just say hi, wave at some of the people, call them out and stuff in the comments. That's great. One great way to interact, because we can't hear the clapping and the amens, is just give those thumbs up and those hearts as you're going along there. And then also, one awesome thing that we're able to do, almost as its own ministry, is we can share our Sunday service here. So if you have a friend or family member that would enjoy just the Word of God and the worship that we're about to dig into, you can actually share what we're all participating in right here. And so I would love to start out with some prayer. We're going to do some music. Jason's bringing the Word. I'm so excited. And so let me just say a quick prayer, and then we'll jump in to some music here. So Lord, I just thank you so much for this time. We've set this time aside to be intentional about our relationship with you, Lord. And we want our hearts and our minds to be a blank slate this morning so that what you bring through the Word of God can impact us, that can change us, that can inspire us, that can just, if we need arms wrapped around us, Lord, but just if we need to feel loved, whatever it is that needs to happen this morning, Lord, we give this time to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful. Of abundance flow, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm bound in the desert place. Though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name.
Every blessing.
Every blessing you pour. Darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name.
Blessed be your name.
Every blessing you pour out on, turn back to grace. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will stay. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glory.
Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
we're going to sing is Our God. You know, and I've always loved, you know, this was written quite a while ago by Chris Tomlin and some others. And I've always loved the chorus and the bridge of this because it says, our God is greater, our God is stronger, our God is higher than any other. And it's our time to proclaim this in our lives. You know, we may think it throughout the week, but as the week goes on and our weeks have been weird, we have to admit to that. Sometimes we need to sing it out loud. Sometimes we need to say it out loud so we can hear ourselves say it. And then during the bridge it says, and if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? If our God is with us, then what could stand against? And so I encourage you guys, proclaim that in your homes this morning, in your living rooms.
Turned into wine, open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you, none like you. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise. There's no
Good morning. It's good to be with you, coming to you from the Guild Gallery here and Yakima, and we are so glad to be together, even if it's not together in the way we would hope to be together, that is in person. And I don't know about you, but as we heard even this week that our quarantine, our stay in place order, the shelter in place order is going to be extended. I don't know about you, but I was mourning that. I was grieving that. I know that those decisions are intended for people's safety, but there's part of me that I just want you to know that I've missed seeing you. I've missed being around you. And I know that being together, gathering is something the church does. Pastor Darren was reminding me that that's something that is the church is known for, gathering. And so thank you for gathering together online today. I'm glad that you're here and we're excited. Let me just remind you that one of the things that we are saying on a regular basis now is that we are not COVID-centered. That's not what is bringing us together today. What is bringing us together today is that we are Christ-centered. We are not COVID-centered. We are Christ-centered. And I hope you, I say, why are we meeting online? I think we're going to have opportunities to meet online even when we get to meet together. I think there's some things that we've learned during this time. I hope that you're growing and you're being teachable even during this time. And I think the Lord has something to teach us this morning, so I hope you're ready for that. And so let me just begin with this. Let's start where we normally do. If you have the app or you're looking at our website, which is harvestcommunitychurch.com, we encourage you today. Do it today. If you can do it right now and you have the ability on a device or two, fill out that connection card. You can find that. You can go to our app. And if you don't have the app, it's free. Go to any of your app stores and Harvest Church Sela. You'll find our app. Fill out that connection card. We'd love to connect with you. We'd love to pray for you. We'd love to just know how to love on you, even if it's not face-to-face. And so that would be important to us. And so make sure you do that today. And then I'm going to encourage you to be generous during this time. Let's talk about being generous people. And right now is not the time to say, I'm not going to be generous, and then go out and buy a massive flat panel TV with your stimulus check. So make sure that you're being generous. In fact, I want to remind you that if we're not generous, our church will cease to exist. That our churches around the country, around the world, will cease to exist without the generosity of God's people. And so you can give online. You can mail in a check. That's just an opportunity for us. You say, what's that going to go toward? We're not meeting in person. Our ministry is all over the world. We have partners all over the world. And so we just didn't want to invite you into that, to be generous people. And so think about that. As we take some time to pray this morning, I want us to be focused on a couple of groups of people. I want us to be praying for our small business owners who are trying to weather this time and trying to care for employees and trying to survive. And so would you be praying for all of our small business owners? So some of them got the stimulus package out of that big CARES initiative. Some of them did not. And so I want you to be praying for those small business owners. And would you be praying for our teachers? Would you be praying for not only our teachers who are paid to be teachers, but now so many that are trying to help out, such as parents who are saying, I'm working on classroom management. That's my big deal, classroom management. And you're thinking about your own kids. And so as we get there, and then I want you to be thinking about folks that are just in need right now, in need of healing in their bodies, in need of just the Lord to encourage them because this has taken a toll on them mentally and taken a toll on them emotionally. And so we're going to go to a time of prayer right now. In fact, if you're meeting with more than one person in the room, would one of you just take the next few moments and pray out loud? Would you pray for our teachers? Would you pray for our small business owners? Would you pray for parents, parents who are part of our church and parents who are not? Would you be praying for our valley, our state, our nation, our world right now? Somebody lead out in prayer and then I'll join you. Father, thank you that you hear all of these prayers. Father, thank you that you hear every one of us. Thank you that you are able to give every one of us the personal attention that we need. Thank you that you're able to meet all of the things that we are carrying in our souls today, on our minds today, our hearts, the things that are heavy for us. Lord, I pray right now. I pray right now for our small businesses, all of the folks that they need to come out on the other side of this, having a business, being able to employ and being able to be productive. Lord, I pray for all of our small business owners. Lord, I pray right now for all of our teachers, our administrators, all of the parents who are trying to finish this school year well. I pray for our students, Jesus, that you would give them stamina and strength and, Lord, give them a teachable spirit. And Lord, today I pray that you would give us a teachable spirit. I pray that we'd be ready to receive what you have for us. Lord, today we pray for those that are hurting. We pray for those that are sick physically, those that are struggling emotionally today, those who are struggling spiritually today. There are so many things that this pandemic has affected, and it's not just the virus that is touching people's lives. So Jesus, show yourself greater. We praise your name. Whether we're together in person or separated, we praise the strong name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. So good to pray with you. So good to do that. Now, I just want to begin our message portion of this time with just a little confession and to give you a little background into how, as I'm doing sermon prep, as I'm working on what God has laid out for us. As you know, maybe this is new for you, but we're going through the book of Romans, second half of your Bible. And as I'm studying each week, this week I was preparing for the message, and I was listening to one of my favorite bands, the band U2, and there it is. This is one of my favorite albums, All That You Can't Leave Behind. By the way, if you ask Pastor Darren or you ask Sharon, this is not something new that has happened. Every week as I'm doing sermon prep, usually I'm shutting the door so I can just be focused on this. I'm not answering the phone at that time. I'm not answering emails at that time. And as I'm working on this, I am listening to music. And you can ask Darren or Sharon this. Usually it involves you two at some point or all the way through. It matters week to week. But as I was listening to this album, All That You Can't Leave Behind, there's a song called Grace. And I thought, oh man. I was really focused on the words because I knew that we would be talking about God's grace together today. And as I was listening, by the way, let's just stop right there and just say, if you think this is a promotional for the band or you want me Pastor Jason wants us to like the band U2, that's not important. You don't have to like the band and you don't have to like the song. But I do want you to really encounter the grace of God and understand it and embrace it deeply today. So I was listening to this song, and I was convinced that the writer of the song has at least wrestled with the concept of grace, which is both beautiful and, I would admit, difficult to comprehend in its fullness. Grace. I want to read just a few of the lyrics of this song to you regarding the concept of grace. It won't be on the screen for you, but listen to these words. This is right out of the song Grace by the band U2. Grace, she takes the blame. She covers the shame, removes the stain. It could be her name. Grace, it's the name for a girl. It's also a thought that changed the world. Now, listen to this next part. She travels outside of karma. She travels outside of karma. Because grace makes beauty out of ugly things. Grace finds beauty in everything. Grace finds goodness in everything. As we understand God's grace together, I want you to really sense how powerful it is, how overwhelming grace is, because grace does cover our shame, and grace does remove sin stain. Grace has changed the world. Now hold on to this. Grace does travel outside of karma. And that needs a little explanation. I want to just contrast for you karma and grace. They both sound very religious, but one is truly man-made and one is heaven-sent. Let's talk about karma first. Karma, a noun, simply meaning this, an informally used regarding destiny or fate. And karma also has this implication, following as effect from a cause, cause and effect, cause and effect. Hang on there. I have a little tickle in my throat, and so I need some water. Here we go. There was a tickle in my throat, and so here is what is going to be the remedy for it, a little bit of karma. Oh, that's good. Doesn't quite satisfy, but it's good. So let's think about this. Karma is especially used in Hinduism or Buddhism, thinking about the sum of all of a person's actions. In fact, all of the actions in Buddhism and Hinduism, karma is related to a person's previous existence. In Hinduism and Buddhism, they believe you have multiple lives and that they believe in reincarnation, and karma follows you all the way through. In fact, karma is what decides your fate in future existences. I can remember my seventh grade teacher who believed in this deeply. And so students, when they would want to derail her from teaching the actual lesson, they would ask her about her previous lives. And she would talk about being a butterfly. My favorite one that she talked about was when she was a rock. And I was like, I don't even, as a seventh grader, I didn't get it. And I'm not sure I still don't get that one. But this is the truth about karma. It summed up in this: if you do good things, you get good things. If you do bad things come to you. That is a simple understanding of karma. Do good, get good. Do bad, get bad. That's karma. In fact, if you think about it, there's some folks throughout scripture that were really talking about karma without talking about the word karma. If you've read through the book of Job, you know that he has three friends who bring this concept of karma to him and say, Job, bad things have happened to you. Therefore, they've reasoned it out. They've used their logic and they say, you must have done bad things because bad things are happening to you. They're simply using logic and saying it's cause and effect. You must have done something bad. Therefore, bad things are happening to you. And they're trying to reason through this with Job. And at the end of the book of Job, we can see that they had flawed logic. In fact, karma is flawed. We'll talk about that in a moment. Let's talk about grace. Grace, a noun, specifically in Christian belief, it is the free and unmerited favor of God. Hang on those words, the free and unmerited favor of God, as manifested in the salvation of sinners, all of us are sinners, and the bestowal of blessings, free, unmerited favor of God. There it is. When you put karma and grace in a comparison contrast, I can tell you that karma is going to feel very just. It's what you earn. It's what you get. It's what's coming to you. In fact, you may have heard it said this way: you get what you deserve. You get what you deserve. You get what's coming to you. You get what you get. Karma, think about it this way: karma is entrapping. Karma is stifling. Karma is ultimately depressing. You get what you get. You get what you get. And then there's grace. Grace is freeing. Grace allows you to finally be able to breathe. Grace is energizing because it is filled with hope, because you don't get what you deserve. You get so much better than you deserve. Karma, you get what you get. Grace, you don't get what you deserve. You get so much more, so much better. I want to put it in terms that you might understand right now. Karma is quarantine. Karma is like quarantine. You stay there. Don't move. This is what you need to do. Where grace is vacation. Grace is freedom. Grace is the absence of fear of contagion. Grace. You say, I don't like that comparison. Listen, if you have been under the oppressive cloud of karma, even as a Christian, many Christians somehow use that syncretism where they mix and match Christianity and other religions like Buddhism and Hinduism, and they put it together. And so you'll see Christians living under the oppressive cloud of karma. If you've been living that way, if you've been thinking about it maybe like this, if anything goes wrong in life, if anything bad happens to you, there's this little voice inside of you that might say, this is what you deserve. This is what you get. This is what's coming to you. You say, well, who taught this? Who taught this? I think it can be taught, but I also think there's something in our spirit, in our flesh, that is misguided. Our feelings can get it wrong. And so today, I want you to get it right. I want you to understand God's grace in a greater way. I want you to be able to have that freedom, to be able to breathe, to have hope, to understand the grace of God. And so let's do this together. Let's understand it as we open our Bibles together. So if you have a Bible, would you take that out? If you're using the app, would you get ready for that? You can see here it is, Greater Than Karma. That's today's message title, Greater Than Karma. And if you're using your Bible, would you go to the second half of your Bible? Would you find the book of Romans, also known as the letter to the church at Rome? And as we go there, we're going to be in Romans 10, the end of Romans 10, and going into Romans 11 today. And we want to see what God's word has to say, not just our own opinions. And so if you have your Bible open, I'm going to begin by reading just two verses, three verses, 19, 20, and 21. Here's what it says, Romans chapter 10, beginning with verse 19. But I ask, did Israel not understand? First, Moses says, I will make you jealous of those who are not a nation. With a foolish nation, I will make you angry. Then Isaiah is so bold as to say, I have been found by those who did not seek me. I have shown myself to those who did not ask for me. And verse 21, but of Israel, he says, all day long I have held out my hands to a disobedient and contrary people. As we get into it today, I want you to answer this in your own mind. Maybe you can say it out loud, that this isn't just some good words for us, but this is God's word for us. Amen. God's word for us. And I think we need to begin to understand this. God's grace, would you note this today? God's grace is extended to undeserving people. God's grace is extended to undeserving people. And as you do that, I want you to note this. That is the definition of grace. If it was given to deserving people, it's not grace. But if it's given to undeserving people, very much grace. And the writer of Romans, the Apostle Paul, you say, you know, I've heard this before. We've been in Romans now. This is our 22nd installment in the book of Romans, our 22nd time together in the book of Romans. We've heard about God's grace. Let's move on to something else. Wait, Wait. You see, the Apostle Paul is using intentional repetition for us here. He's using intentional repetition. Very few times in life do we understand something after hearing it only once. Very few times. Even if you're a quick to learn person. Even if you're very astute and you're very understanding of even difficult concepts. Very few times do we understand something only after hearing it one time. In fact, the Apostle Paul is using this repetition technique as a teaching technique. And we can understand that because it is employed at every level of education. Intentional repetition. It's used to train animals. You say the same command over and over and over. It can be used to teach complex medical procedures. You train and you practice and then you do it and you do it and you do it correctly again and again. You teach, you reteach. You teach, you reteach. Parents, you understand this concept. You understand this concept. It is what we use to help our kids so many times to make sure that they get very important messages through to their minds and through to their hearts very quickly. When we say to a young child, don't touch that, that's hot. Remember, this is hot, don't touch it. If you touch it, you'll get burned. Don't touch this, it's hot. We don't want them to be burned in that way. We say things like this, stop and look both ways when you're riding your bike. Stop at the stop sign, look both ways before crossing the road. Remember, look both ways before crossing the road. We say it again and again. How about this when you're training up a new driver? Remember, when you're checking your blind spot, you don't need to let go of the wheel. Don't let go of the wheel when you're checking your blind spot. In fact, don't turn as you're checking your blind spot. You can know this. Driver's ed instructors, we love you. We appreciate you so much. Now, here's what we're learning about God's grace. God's grace is extended to undeserving people. And if you can understand that when we say that, it's all of us. We're undeserving people. You know that God's grace was extended to Abraham, the father of the Jewish nation. And he understood very clearly that he was undeserving, that God chose him, God picked him out and had plans for him. He understood that he was undeserving. But then something happened as his family grew into a nation, generation upon generation. There was a change where the people of Israel began to believe, the nation of Israel, the Jewish people, began to believe that they were deserving, that they really did deserve God's grace. And so right here, the Apostle Paul is saying, do you remember that Moses had to remind you that you were undeserving and how God was going to accomplish that? Moses had to remind you, and then the prophet Isaiah had to remind you that you were undeserving and it was all God's grace in your life. Isaiah is saying this, grace is never to be understood that we are in a deserving category. That's a misunderstanding. You don't understand grace if you see yourself in the deserving category. And so, really, the Apostle Paul is pointing out here for us and for the people of Israel, which he is a part of the people of Israel. He is Jewish. He's saying, how do you get the attention of people who think they're deserving? How do you get their attention? How do you get them to see that they are in the same category as every other person? They're undeserving as well. The Lord did this by opening the door wide. I love this. He opened the door wide to the non-Jewish people, to Gentiles. And the Gentiles are flooding in. They're flooding into the people of God. They're flooding in to the family of God. And he's saying, how do I wake up those that think they're deserving? I'll let all the undeserving in. I'll let them in and they'll see them going past them. This happens in this way in our lives. You're going to the bank. The lobby is closed because of the quarantine. And so you're rounding the building, getting ready to go into the drive-through, and you're assessing as you pull up which lane is moving faster. Do you do this? This can happen at Fred Meyer as well. This can happen in any store where you're assessing which lane is moving faster. This happened to me as I jumped into the drive-through this past week, and I'm saying, okay, which lane is moving faster? I think it's that one. And so you go over and you get into that lane because you think it's moving faster, and then you realize that the other lane is passing you and passing you and passing you. People that came in behind you are doing their banking and leaving, and you're still in line. And you're realizing you didn't have any power. You didn't have it right. You got it wrong. And in fact, as I was thinking about this week, that's what was happening to the people of Israel. Moses said this would happen. Isaiah said this would happen. That people who you see as undeserving, they're coming right in. And you're stuck. It's meant to wake you up. Now, I want you to focus on a statement with me for a moment that should bring you hope. Look at verse 21 with me, where it says this. But of Israel, he says, all day long I have held out my hands to a disobedient and contrary people. That's such a beautiful picture. It's the Father extending his hands to us and saying, I'm holding out my hands. This is specifically directed to the Jewish people, but it also has implications for us, for you and I. I want you to picture right now that the Lord today is standing with his hands open and saying, I want to receive you. Come. It's okay. I'm ready. I'm not going to treat you with karma. I'm going to treat you with grace. Maybe for years you have swatted his hand away, said, I'm not interested. I'm not interested. The Lord is still holding his hands out to you. Maybe for years you've had this posture, arms crossed, head turned away, just ignoring God, ignoring his grace. It says to you in verse 21 that his hands are still extended. All day long, I have held out my hands to a disobedient and contrary people. Oh yeah, well, he only accepts the good people. There are no good people. And his hands are still extended. There are no good people. And yet he still, all day long, is extending himself in grace. It is a beautiful picture. Today, his arms are outstretched to you. Today, his arms are outstretched to me. Today, he is saying, I am waiting for you. Our God is gracious. Our God is gracious. Let's see how he pushes this understanding of grace a little further in chapter 11. It says this, verse 1. I ask then, has God rejected his people? By no means. Absolutely not. For I myself am an Israelite, the Apostle Paul speaking here, a descendant of Abraham, a member of the tribe of Benjamin. God has not rejected his people whom he foreknew. Do you not know the scripture, what the scripture says of Elijah, how he appeals to God against Israel? Here's what Elijah said. Lord, they have killed your prophets. They have demolished your altars, and I alone am left, and they seek my life. But what is God's reply to him? I have kept for myself 7,000 men who have not bowed the knee to Baal. So too, at the present time, there is a remnant chosen by, there it is, grace. But if it is by grace, it is no longer on the basis of works. Otherwise, grace would no longer be grace. If you could earn it, it's not grace. If you think you deserve it, it's not grace. Let's understand this. Number two today, God's grace is being extended today. I love it where it says that in the present time, that is to this very moment, to this very moment, God's grace is being extended. And I want to just give you a couple of categories that we see in our world today, and very much in the world in which Paul the Apostle was writing. We see four groups of people. This is not an exhaustive list, but see if you don't fit into one of these categories. Fit yourself into that category, not someone else. God's grace is being extended today to the disobedient. But what do you mean by disobedient? When you know what is right, but you don't care. You know that what you're doing, what you're thinking, what you're saying is wrong, but you don't care. You're going to do it anyway. You know that you're driving toward a cliff, but instead of hitting the brakes, you put both feet down on the gas pedal. You are pushing the accelerator to the floor, even though you know the cliff is in front of you. I would just say that's a good definition of disobedience. I know this is wrong. I'm doing it anyway. And then there's the group we call the contrarians. Maybe you know someone who is a contrarian. Maybe you are a contrarian. If I just said maybe you are a contrarian, you'd probably disagree with that. That's contrarian. I don't know if you're a contrarian or you know somebody who is. They are easy to identify. They act as if they know everything. If you make a suggestion, they will shoot it down without hesitation, even if they don't know what they're talking about. You say, I love the color blue. Blue's the worst. Blue's the worst. Yellow is so much better. I love the color white. Black. Black all day long. Black. Listen, a contrarian is a difficult person to live with. And yet, they're around us. Then there's the ultra religious. These folks look like they have it all together. Wow. They dress right. They got a great haircut even during the quarantine. How's that happening? They think they have it all together. They think they don't need God because they see themselves as little gods. Well, at least I'm not as bad as that person. The ultra-religious. And then finally, this one. The extraordinary. Not extraordinary, extraordinary. This is just your average, everyday individual. Not too good. Not too bad, just right. Just getting by and still in need of a Savior. Now, let's go back to that statement. All day long, His hands are extended. All day long to the disobedient. All day long, His hands are extended to the contrarian. All day long, His hands are extended to the ultra-religious. All day long, His hands are extended to the extraordinary. Now, I want you to think about if you were to place yourself in one of those four categories, what would it be? And this is where you have to stop for a moment and say, please stop assessing your parents, stop assessing your siblings, stop assessing your classmates, your teammates, your coworkers. You put yourself into one of those categories. Maybe you're in the disobedient category, maybe in the contrarian category, maybe in the ultra-religious category, or just in the extraordinary category. Every category, God is extending His hands to you. He's extending His hands to you. Now, I want you to hear this as the Apostle Paul drives this home with two illustrations. First, a personal illustration, and then an illustration out of history. The power of a personal testimony. Don't underestimate your personal story, what God has done for you. You see, the Apostle Paul uses his own story to illustrate that God is still extending His grace today. His story is that of the ultra-religious person who was confronted by the grace of God. He was the really, really good guy, hair just right. Clothes just right. His car was never dirty. His home spotless. Everybody would say, surely he's got it together. Surely God would love him. He had to be confronted by the grace of God. You see, when he answers this question, has God rejected his people, the people of Israel? He says, no, absolutely not. By no means. Paul was saying, I'm as Jewish as it gets. If you came and said to Paul, hey, Paul, what's your favorite superhero? He'd say, Moses. Hey, Paul, what's your favorite political figure? King David. Hey, Paul, what's your favorite day of the week? Sabbath. Hey, Paul, what's your favorite dessert? Unleavened bread. He was as Jewish as it gets. And yet he still needed grace. He was relying on his heritage. He was relying on his accomplishments. He was relying on all of the things that truly fit in the karma category. If you do good, you get good. If you do bad, you get bad. That doesn't sound like God's grace. And it wasn't until the Apostle Paul was blinded by the presence of Jesus, and you can read about this in the first chapters of the book of Acts. It wasn't until he was blinded by the presence of Jesus while he was on his way to abuse, mistreat, incarcerate the followers of Jesus. It wasn't until the grace of Jesus got in his face. See, Jesus' grace confronted him. And today I would hope that the grace of God would lovingly confront those of us who say, we don't need it. Jesus has not forgotten his people. The Apostle Paul is living proof of that. He said he's not forgotten his people. He's not forgotten people. His hands are still extended today. He's still changing hearts among Jewish people and Gentile people, non-Jewish people alike. And that's good news for you today. That's good news for me today. That's good news for your cousin. That's good news for your sister. That's good news for your childhood friend. It's good news. The Apostle Paul is saying, I'm living proof that God's grace is greater than karma. And finally, the power of history's testimony. He's going to dig into something out of the Hebrew scriptures, out of what we call the Old Testament. In fact, if you have a moment to flip a few pages forward and see Romans chapter 15, verse 4, this will help you understand why God's grace and what was written about in the Old Testament is important for you. It says in Romans 15, verse 4, for whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction. It's for us that it was written down. That through endurance and through the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. I don't know if you have this understanding that there was God was this way in the Old Testament, and now he operates in this way. It's almost like he's a different God. And the truth is, he's not a different God. He's been gracious all along. In fact, when we read about how he describes himself, that he always begins with mercy and grace. He's gracious and compassionate. He's showing love to thousands of generations. That's who he is. He always leads with grace. See, God's grace has been documented. And you say, where's it been documented? This is why we say all of God's word is for you. Read about how his grace has been documented for you, that you can see how he has worked and worked and worked. The Apostle Paul is going to point out an account out of 1 Kings chapter 19. You might go back and read this whole story about the prophet Elijah, who God used to do powerful, powerful things for his glory, for God's glory. And yet, the prophet Elijah is running for his life from the wicked queen Jezebel. And he arrives at a cave, and God says, come out of the cave, come out. I want to talk to you. And immediately, Elijah is ready with a speech. God says, what are you doing here, Elijah? What are you doing here? And he begins this speech. Everybody's bad except for me. They're all disobedient. They're all contrarians. They're all ultra-religious for false gods. They're all just ordinary people living out karma. They all deserve what they get. Give it to them, God. Give them justice. They deserve to be punished. They deserve all of your wrath being saved up for them. Give it to them, God. Elijah is pouring out a rehearsed speech that he has been working on for some time. Now, let's just stop for a moment. Do you have any of these rehearsed speeches? Maybe you went over it in your mind this morning. Do you have speeches like this that you've been honing and crafting and saying, if I wrote this down, I would get a Pulitzer because I've crafted it so well. And I'm just waiting for the right time to deliver it. Maybe this speech is something you want to say to your ex-spouse. And they deserve what all that you've saved up for them. Maybe this is for your teacher in junior high who said some careless words and they have been lodged in your brain since that time. Maybe these are words for your boss or a coach. Maybe these are words for your mom or your dad who failed you. Maybe it is someone who has already passed away, and you're like, if I could see them right now, here's what I'd tell them. Do you have any rehearsed speeches like Elijah did? Because this speech didn't just come out on the fly. He was ready. And here's how he saw himself. I have been faithful. I've been obedient. But the one thing that Elijah had not been, which God was and is gracious. Elijah did great at justice. He did okay at mercy, but he had not ventured into the gracious category. And see, that's something we're supposed to learn. When we receive God's grace, when we're the recipients of God's grace, we are then to extend God's grace to others. That doesn't mean being a doormat. That doesn't mean just taking abuse endlessly. That doesn't mean that. But it does mean extending forgiveness and mercy and kindness to undeserving people just like us. Maybe you have a speech, and that speech is going to have to go in the shredder. You're going to have to let go of that speech. You're going to need to have a fire, and you're going to need to let that speech go up in smoke. You're going to need to let go of that speech, and you're going to need to forgive people who have hurt you. You're ready to receive God's grace. Amen. And when you receive God's grace, he is going to help you extend his grace. In fact, let me give you the bottom line today. The bottom line is this. History records, and personal account after personal account records, that our God has always been a God of grace. A God who leads with grace. Maybe you've been living far too long under a false religion, a false understanding of what God wants from you. You've been living under karma instead of grace. You've been willing to receive God's mercy, but you want other people to get what they get. I would urge you just let God's Spirit convict you of that today, that you would turn from that today. The biblical word is to repent and move away from it completely. Far too long has karma reigned. It is time for God's grace to flood in and change everything. If you say, no, I want to stay under karma, then you want to stay living as disobedient, contrarian, ultra-religious, or just everyday, ordinary people. And God has greater plans for you. God has greater plans for us. God's grace is greater. Free, unmerited favor. It's a gift. I want to just pray for us right now. Maybe you've never received God's grace. Maybe you've never received it. Today's the day. Today, May the 3rd, 2020, would be the day that you would receive God's grace, that He would cover the stain, remove the shame, that He would do that for you. And then I want to pray for those that have received God's grace, but have been very reluctant to extend His grace to others, that God would challenge you today. Would you pray with me? Father, today we're convicted that whether we have admitted it in the past or not, that we live like karma is real. We live like that is the guiding principle of this world and this universe, and it's how it should be. And Lord, that's not how it should be. Your grace is how it should be. It's how you've always operated. Lord, for those that don't know you today, I pray that today they would simply come to you, Jesus, and say, Jesus, I need your grace. I receive your grace today. I receive your forgiveness today. I want to follow you. I want my life to reflect your grace. Jesus, change me. Forgive me. Give me that new life, that gracious life that only you can give. And Lord, for those that know you, I pray that we would not be people who live gracious and receiving your grace, but very much in a karma way where we have not extended it. Lord, I pray that you would forgive us and that you would help us, that we would be gracious people following our gracious God. Thank you that you love undeserving people like us. We praise the name of Jesus. Amen. Harvest, it is so good to be with you. And God is going to be gracious to us even during this time. He's helping us. And I pray that you would receive His grace this week and you would extend His grace this week. And if nobody else tells you, that you would hear the words, you are loved deep in your spirit by a gracious God. And that you would be able to extend that love to others. Now let's finish our service together by worshiping and celebrating with others who have received that grace as well. Good to see you, Harvest.